We are discussing the topic of how to be a successful group or how to be a successful team despite changes in seasons. There are groups that start and groups that die continuously. The question is, what makes a group last? I want to share an example of a group I started in 1974. I left my level 73, and in 1973 December, I went for a conference in Kisumu that was organized by somebody called T.L. Osborne. And the emphasis of the conference was being conscious of other people who do not know Christ. And of course, the results were not out ahead of time. I became a high school teacher in what those days was called Harambee School. Aringo, the Minister of Education, Aringo, removed that word, Harambee, so people who are below 30 may not know what Harambee schools are. But if you're above 40, you must know what Harambee schools are. So that's what I was teaching. And it is at that moment I started gathering young people so that we would start going around. I come from Nyandarua County. That we would start going around the place, talking to students, talking to other people about their need to know God. That group is still running today. In fact, we had a meeting last Sunday. Last Sunday, but one. So it's still going on. That's how many years? 74 to date is how many years?
43 years.
So it's older than some of you here. Although maybe your faces are cheating me. You look young. the faces are cheating me that you are younger than that period of time. And so I was told about this idea of groups going through and continuing to be successful in respect of seasons, I thought of our group. The first thing that happened in the group was, since the idea came to me, and I'm the one who was gathering other people, they just asked me to be chairman. Initially, it was not formal. We did not think of structures. So from between 74 to 77, I left university in 77, so it's more than 40 years since I left university. And then after that, I was no more available to the group. There wasn't formal AGMs and things like that. We were just doing working things together and seeing the results come. But now we formalized, got registered, and now we needed to have structures. And obviously they asked me to be chairman. So I continued being chairman. Every time I do elections, I'm returned, until I started smelling a rat, that if I moved out, the group could die. So that it's doing well during this season because I'm available if I moved out. And sure enough, among the young people we started with, we had somebody go to the US in 1980, has never come back except to visit. So he's been in America for eight years. Another one went 84 because he was in Air Force, and there were many of those people that were in the Air Force who were fired. Then he left for the U.S. That's 82. In 84, he left 84. And again, he settled in America. And these are the key people in the leadership. And I started thinking, one of the things that will happen is that if I also relocate, another one, by the way, joined the U.N. and has been with the U.N. from that time until he just retired last year. So he has come back to Kenya last year. Now he's a retiree in his 60s. So, and I realized that alone. So I moved a motion in our AGM that we need to have a structure that allows some changes in the way things are done, such that even if one person moved, the group can continue. And that proved to be a real big solution, because now the rule was you could not continue in one position forever. So automatically I had already overdone it, so I was moved. And I've never become chairman again. but I'm as active in the group up to now. I'm still active, but not the leadership. In fact, many since other people have joined, many of the people in the leadership were not alive when we when we started the group. And they're the ones who lead. They tell me, do this, I do that, I do exactly what they tell me. They are the leaders. But that has helped the group to have some stability that has allowed it to go. And I've founded many groups. But if I spend all my time talking about the groups and their challenges, it may not be all you want to hear. But the point I want to say is that changes happen. Like, for example, you are young and unmarried. Then after that, people started getting married. By marrying, strangers to the group are joining in. And they wonder, why do you have to keep going for these meetings? Now, when your spouse tells you that, soon enough, you don't resign. You simply drop off. My wife likes saying that adults vote with their legs. They never talk. They just disappear. So you and you always have a good reason. Oh, you didn't come to the meeting. Why? Oh, there was this client. Those clients have always been there, but as long as they were committed, they would tell the client not to show up. Now the client is a good reason. And they're not lying, but they are telling the truth. There's a client who came. But that, the disappearance one after the other, is the beginning of the death of the group. And it happens like that. Like now, marriage was quite a challenge. Then, initially, we had small children. So you go for meetings, and that baby is crying, it becomes a choir. And it can become quite a disturbing thing when you're having a meeting, and that one stops crying, the other one begins. That's a season that you have to go through and learn how to. Like, we used to have meetings, and our wives would cook. Then we realize that can't work when everybody is that busy, and then the wives are not getting involved. So we decided to be going somewhere where we pay somebody else to cook and we all can get involved. We also started going with somebody, when we go for a meeting, we go with somebody who can take our children, small children, for Sunday school, so that the mothers and fathers can be together. What I'm trying to get you to see is that these changes happen. Then after some time, our children finish, our last born finished university 07. So for the last 10 years, there isn't, you know, that now we are just two of us. And so seasons are changing. How do you continue the team? What kind of things? The needs are changing, isn't it? So if you are not conscious, people finally wonder, why do I go for this meeting? Because you're not conscious about the changes that are taking place. And I thought that as we try to deal with this, we do not start thinking about politics as the changes. For now, one of the big issues is politics. But you need to look at your social circumstances and how they are changing. And you ask yourself, are we meeting the new changes, the new needs, because of sociological changes? Now, if you met in a gubaru, you are no longer in the gubaru. Am I right?
Yes.
Some of you. So you have to find out, how do you cope with people who are not doing gubaru? Because that's a change. So you have to find a way of meeting the changing needs. Don't assume the needs have remained the same. And that will be quite important. However, I want to share a few things why you must remain in the group despite the changes. Because what I've been describing are people on the periphery who are looking, are they meeting my need? And they disappear. If you're here an insider, you should influence the changes yourself, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Rather than be a critic, telling people that they are not changing. Please be committed. Somebody has said, and I support him, the difference between success and failure is the greatness of the team. The difference between success and failure is a great team. Now, if you are going to be a successful person, it will mean you learn how to work with others. If you can't work with others, your ability to succeed will be quite a challenge. Three things are very critical if you are going to continue as a group. First of all, you must remain steadfast and immovable. Steadfast and immovable.
Steadfast means you hold on to what the group is doing, in the sense that you know what it is, and I'll be coming back to that point. You know what it is, and you hold on to it. You keep reminding the group, this is the reason we meet. I think that will be for that. You are holding it steadfast. Immovable means that you don't become a sensitive person. One of the things that kills a group are people who need to put a signboard around them, written, handle with care, right side up. You know, when you're importing eggs, that's what you write on the carton, isn't it? And some members of the group, I'm not suggesting you raise your hands, but some members of the group are that sensitive. Every time you say something, that she must have been talking about
me.
The problem is not the group. The problem is
you.
Because why must you assume I'm talking about you? Now, the real you have a weakness and you are not a team player. Team players always give what is called the benefit of doubt. You cannot work in a team unless you know what it means to give benefit of doubt. I still remember in the 70s, quoting Rebecca, and we used to meet, those of you who are older and know Nairobi, know that the meeting point of all buses was Tusker. Remember Tusker?
Yes.
Yeah, that's where everybody met. So you come with your bus, and then your girlfriend is coming, and you meet there, then agree where to go. That's where we used to meet. And then I'm seated there, and she's not coming on time. And you are boiling.
And there were no mobile phones.
And no, of course there were no mobile phones. In the 70s. Leave alone mobile. Even house phones. Even house phones were for the rich. You only had your phone in your office. Now, so it becomes, start boiling. And by the time the person comes, they are coming excited to meet you, but your face is telling another story. It is stuck at 6 o'clock. You know, a long face. Yeah. And she's coming at 2:45, smiling. Now, you need to understand, when the two faces, one at 2:45 and the other one at 6 o'clock meet, there'll be a clash, isn't it? And we started saying, why don't you start learning the principle of giving benefit of doubt? In other words, if my girlfriend is coming late and I know she loves me, I should assume there must be something very serious holding her. Not I know her. She cannot just make me stand there looking at buses. There must be a good reason. You know, as soon as I start thinking, oh, the bus may have been broken down, there may have been an accident, instead of getting to boil, I start praying for her. Oh, God, help her. Because I'm assuming there's a serious issue. So I start praying for her. By the time she comes, she has come 1 hour late, but I'm so happy. She's looking okay. She has not been hurt. Now, when she finally say, what hurt you? If it turns out there was no good reason, now I cannot get annoyed properly. Now, you see, now there is no reason. It's okay to get annoyed at that point. But if I get annoyed only for her to come and mention there was an accident, I'll be a fool, isn't it? I would have suffered for an hour. And now once I hear what the problem is, I have to swallow my pride, isn't it? So why punish yourself? Start by assuming, giving the person the benefit of
doubt.
So when people talk, and the way they are talking, you think is because they know you are from Jubilee. They are an anikata. Eh? You need to, first of all, give them the benefit of
doubt.
Once you give them the benefit of doubt, you're not even raise it in a meeting. Once you have gone, you just call Sister Kokoko. And ask Sister Kokoko, you know, I was a little confused about what you were saying. Sister Kokoko, that one. You know, it's only I had known it enough time. I would have told you about it. Then she tells you and you say, hey, isn't it good? I never told you what I was thinking. Now, you need to understand, if you don't learn that principle, what is it called? Giving a benefit of doubt. That does not mean you're not finally catch up with the person. But you do not punish yourself in advance. You wait until you meet the person and you are able to deal with it. That is, remember, I'm now discussing immovable. In other words, there is a force to move you, but you're refusing to be moved. until you can verify the facts. And that's important. So that you must determine as a person, you remain steadfast and immovable. I know we are discussing this group. Cotton.
Yes.
I'm pronouncing it correctly?
Yes, cotton. C-O-T-T-E-N.
Cotton. Yeah. Now, I know I'm discussing that, but you know it's also about your marriage.
Yes.
You know, the guy comes, and you think, the way he is looking, he has been to a bad place. And then from the gate, you start telling him, I know. When, just tell me which particular dog you had this time. Do you know it caused chaos? Because when he knows he is coming from the office for sure, and you're accusing him of something he has not done, studies show that that will drive him to actually do it. The other day I was listening to a program on the radio, and people started ringing in. So even me, the first time I slept out, was because my mother accused me of having a boyfriend. I never had. That I'm sleeping in the boys. So I decided to sleep only. Now, you see, you get pregnant and mess up your life. But you are doing it to punish your mother. It's pretty foolish. But that's how foolish we are, generally speaking. So you need to understand that idea of not giving benefits of doubt might not punish the other person as much as you punish
yourself.
It will punish you. And so you need to understand that idea of being sensitive is not a sign of maturity and is not good for you in the long term. You know, the other day, my wife and I like walking at Jeffrey's. There's a place in Lovington called Jeffrey's, which is very nice because there are no cars. You just walk. In our 60s, running is a little difficult. So we just walk. We do about 5 kilometers of walking. And you're not walking, you're just walking around a place. And the other day we watched somebody. Somebody was with a small child, must be 3 or 4 years. And the child was running. I think it was not the mother, it was auntie. The child was running and telling the aunt, I'm beating you, I'm beating you. Then the child runs. The aunt decided to run and go ahead. The child stopped and started crying. You see, she at the age of 4, he must beat the aunt. So if the aunt does not want him to cry, is to agree to be defeated. And you know the funny thing, the adult exactly like that. Where you are so sensitive, the only way people can handle you is by stopping talking. In other words, the meeting cannot talk sensitive matters. Not when Kokoko is there. They are treating you. And you feel nice. They are no longer talking. But you need to understand, it's not a sign of maturity. That idea of being sensitive is something you want to deal with. And that's what you mean by being immovable. Being immovable. You need to understand that the tallest tree in an area is the one that gets the most wind. She's talking about being steadfast and immovable. The tallest tree in the forest or in an area is always the one that takes it. You know, the shorter trees will not get, they are called wind breakers. They will be broken by the big ones. But the tall one, nothing can help. The tallest tree gets wind. What does that mean? That if you are in the group and you are the one doing certain things, you need to understand you are the tallest tree. And you are going to get a lot of wind. So, you know, somebody said, because you see, I'm still talking about this sensitivity. I hear you are talking about me. What? Who gave you permission to talk about me? Now, you need to understand, if people are not talking about you, you are not making an impact. If you make an impact, people must talk about you. So, when people talk about you, it means you are catching the wind. Are we together?
Yes.
And you need to not sit there wondering, hey, what are they saying now? I did not attend last month's meeting. They must have been discussing me. Now, if they are discussing you, it means you are having an impact. It's something you don't. And I want to tell you, people like Raira and Uhuru, we talk to them continuously, isn't it? We talk about them continuously. Now, why? Because they have an influence. So you need to start stopping the idea of wanting people not to talk about you. Because then you must, if you don't want people to talk about you, do nothing. Do nothing. You know, I give talks quite a lot. But sometimes after talk, I said, why did I say that? And I feel like the best thing is stop talking. Because every time I talk, there will be something I will say which I will regret later. But when I'm very discouraged, somebody just comes and says, hey, you may not remember me, but you, at least the first time I was invited to speak in a university was 1977, September 77. So at least for the last 40 years, I've been speaking in campuses all over the country. This year must have been to more than 20 campuses. So I meet somebody, I know that time they are young. Now when I meet them, people who were in the university 40 years ago, they actually, their children have also finished university. They are old men. I say, do you remember what you said in 1978? And they can remember the details. Now, they don't normally tell me the bad ones, even if they remember. They tell me the good ones. It means that there is something good despite the something bad. Are we together?
Yes.
So you need to start not caring too much about what people are saying. After all, the truth is, what they say cannot harm you. Am I right? So in a group like this, when people become that sensitive, you know, like, let me give you an example, and this is a sensitive one. You will forgive me for using it. You don't have a child. And then somebody who has a child is talking about how the daughter has now gone to Alliance. That's my old school. It's not the Nazareth. It's better, but it's my old school. Now, and how they are doing well. You have no child to go to primary, even to go to high school. You can feel like, I'm leaving the group. I'm just leaving the group. Surely. Don't they know I don't have a child? Ask yourself, must they stop rejoicing? Isn't even if that child was yours and has gone to Alliance, wouldn't you be happy? Why don't you want your friend to also be happy? You want to hold on to any joy because of him. And you know, it's exactly the same. When, for example, the elections were annulled, all over the Jubilee areas, it was morning time. Nobody believed it could happen. It has never happened in Africa. Nobody believed. You see, there was no mental preparation. You know, in a competition, we knew one might win, the other one can lose. In this one, we never gave it a chance. Now, when it happened, what happens? The people in NASA do not understand why you are not rejoicing with them. The people in Jubilee don't understand why you are
not crying
when you are rejoicing. Now, are you getting my point? You need to start looking and see, these people do not even think they can win the election, they can win the court case. Surely, isn't it a nice feeling? Why don't you want them to rejoice? Allow them to rejoice. Okay, you may not be rejoicing, and I'm not asking you to rejoice, but please allow the other people to rejoice. And when they come for a meeting like that, and they are still smiling, they're 2:45, please don't be at 6 o'clock. Try to look. At least don't look like you want them to stop. But I'm asking an impossible thing, isn't it? It requires a lot of maturity. And it's called empathy, which is my next principle. The first principle was giving a benefit of doubt. The other one is called empathy. Empathy is not sympathy. Sympathy is sympathizing with the other person, feeling, oh, pole, oh yeah. That is sympathy. Empathy is placing yourself in their shoes and feeling their pain. In other words, it's like you are feeling the one feeling the pain. That's empathy. If you want this group to do well, you must go beyond sympathy into empathy. Empathy is where you, even when you are rejoicing, you picture the other person. And you know they are not rejoicing. So, whereas I have told the person not to rejoice, not to stop you, I'm now talking to you to say, remember, in your presence, there is a woman who doesn't have a child. So find a way of rejoicing without overflowing. Whatever that means. I think it's important. If you are aware that your guy has won the Supreme Court, but be aware there are people who are still in shock. And even for the doubt that people are in shock, Uhuru has apologized. The other day he was talking to Kisi and says, I lost my temper, I was angry. That means he admits he was speaking, not lying himself, calling people akora. Now, you need to understand it. Well, that tells you the guy was in shock. Now, when you start that simple empathizing, it means if you're another person, you place yourself in the shoes of the president. And although you don't agree with him, you understand him. In other words, if you're rejoicing about your child going to alliance, and there's a woman here without a child, you just remember, if I was the one without a child, I would feel the pain. So when the other person does not look like they're rejoicing with you, you understand. You know what I'm saying? Some people are jealous. She's not jealous. She's only in pain. Am I communicating? And that is empathy, is what helps. Empathy will mean you act on the understanding you have, but you also act on the understanding of the other person. Last 2 weeks ago, the week of the elections, I was training some people in Ghana, Kumasi, Ghana. That's part of what I do now after I retired. I was training some regional managers of their Forest Commission. Forest and Wildlife, their top leaders were in Kumasi for training. And one of the topics I discussed with them is called emotional intelligence, which is when I went to university, even when I did my master's, it was not a normal word. Now it's a current word, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And what is emotional intelligence? Emotional intelligence is not equal to IQ. You can be very bright, but without any emotional intelligence. Emotional intelligence, number one, is the ability to understand your emotions, to understand yourself, understand where you are. And sometimes when you understand that, you understand you are angry. Once you know you are angry, you will not talk. Somebody with emotional intelligence will not talk out of anger. Because they know they're angry, they know it is the wrong time to talk. But people without emotional intelligence says, but they annoyed me. And the fact that they annoyed you are not a victim. You can stop yourself. Everyone will understand if you erupt. But a mature person will manage the eruption. So the fact that you are erupting when you have done something wrong to you just shows how little emotional intelligence you have. But that's not the end of emotional intelligence. Emotional intelligence is empathy, understanding the emotions of the other person. That means somebody can wake up and call you dog. Now, they are so annoyed, they just call you a dog. Now, emotional intelligence means you put yourself in their shoes, understand what has annoyed them to the point of insanity, because obviously for them to call you a dog, they can't be normal. But you know yourself. Dogs normally are on four legs. You have only got two. So you know they are suffering from emotional insanity. Am I communicating?
Yeah.
So they require more sympathy than condemnation. So emotional intelligence tells you the person will call you a dog and you smile. Because you know once they cool, they will know what they have said was the wrong thing. So don't try to. At that time, emotional intelligence tells you, even if I talk, they can't listen. Am I right? Yeah. You say something, your husband is totally annoyed. And that's when you want to give him your PhD knowledge on the subject. Now, it's the wrong time. The guy cannot hear. Let him boil until the kettle comes down. Once he is now himself, you don't have to give a long lecture. He'll understand what he was doing was wrong. Most teams don't work, whether it's a marriage team or a chama like this one. They will not work until people have emotional intelligence. And I know that's not my subject today, but I'm trying to get you to give you principles that can help you to handle the challenges. So you must learn how to ask yourself, why has the person said what they have actually said? Once you understand them, you start operating from the other person's point of view. And this is a biblical principle. It's in Romans chapter 12, where he is saying you must place yourself in the other person's shoe and do what is good in the eyes of everyone. That's what Romans 12 says. Do things that are good in the eyes of everyone. That means in your eye, they look good. If they look bad in the other person's eye, be careful about doing them. Although in your eye, they look okay. And that's what you are talking about. Your ability to start understanding, although what I have said is totally innocent. I was just talking about my son going to Alliance. Surely, what's wrong with that? But in the eyes of a woman without a child, it is wrong. It doesn't make it wrong. It's wrong on the perspective of this person, isn't it? Mm. But you know what we normally do is to defend yourself. Wake up, grow up, young girl. What's wrong with me rejoicing? Now, you are not placing yourself in the other person's shoes. If you did, you know you are not wrong, but you now start operating from the other person's point of view. See things or do things that are good in the eyes of everyone. It's a biblical principle. And that will help you. Being this tree that is having influence in the group, you understand you'll catch more wind. And as you catch more wind, it shakes your tree and the roots can go deeper. The taller the tree, the deeper the roots. After all, the reason why they're so tall is because the roots have gone to the water table. So that even when it's dry, all other trees are drying up, but the tall tree has roots, tap root, so deep, they are still green. Am I right? So that's what you should be. The kind of person who agrees to be criticized, laughed at, and you're still in the group. You can't leave the group because of people. You understand them. Therefore, you do not leave the group because of what they are doing or not doing. Because you are able to take the wind. And your roots going deeper. You know, my post box is in City Square. And I was working for Shell, so I used to walk from Shell BP House, now the Deputy President's office. I used to walk to take my letters during the lunch hour. When they were building Times Tower, and you know the bridge is high, I got to a level, I told my wife, these people, what's wrong with them? They kept going down. I had never seen such depth. They were down. Then they went down. Do you know there are several floors in Times Tower, KRA place? They are carried several floors down. It's not one floor. It's not one basement. And I don't think there had been another building. You know, it's the highest building. By that time, it was the highest building in Kenya. They actually kept going down until I asked, what's wrong with them? Why are they going further and further? Did they forget they had promised us a skyscraper? An architect told me, the higher the building, the deeper the foundation. It is the determination of how you want to go that determines how deep you should go. Do you really want to be a skyscraper in your business? Do you want to be a skyscraper as a group? Then you must agree to go deep. So that a little wind will not bring you down. So when you really see yourself, I'm not coming to the next meeting, why the way the chairman talked, why you know, sister so and so is a kiberebere sana, you know. Remember, it's just a sign your roots are rather shallow. That's why you are shaken by a small wind, and I think it will be important. My suggestion is learn to choose to stand firm on the Bible. Because all these things I've been saying are good advice. You know, like now when I was in Kumasi, since it's not a Christian meeting, I can't tell them about the Bible. But in the back of my mind, I know. These principles are Bible principles. It's only I'm giving them as management principles. Only the Bible can help you. You know, the Bible word remains true in every season. So the word of God will not change because Jubilee is up, or because Raira is up, or because Jubilee is down. Right? You know, if you stick yourself to God's word and stand firm on it, it will certainly help you. And then number two, learn to pray constantly. 1 Thessalonians 5:17, pray without ceasing. I normally tell people prayer is like breathing. You cannot get born again unless you pray. Every time I have led somebody to the Lord, I pray for them, but I don't leave until they can pray. Because prayer is like breathing. You learn how to talk to God. How can you say you're a Christian if you don't talk to God? Then you pray. But sometimes you feel like I've been a Christian since I put up my hand in a meeting. It's just over 50 years ago. And sometimes you feel like, hey, I prayed for so long, I can stop. Then I remember, it's the same thing. At the hospital, I was not in a body in a hospital, I was born in a village. When I was born, I started breathing. In fact, I'm told by, where is the nurse? Yeah, I'm told by the nurse, if a baby does not cry within 4 minutes, there'll be brain damage. So I hear these people can be cruel. If the baby doesn't cry quickly, they get a starter needle and prick the baby. Sounds cruel, isn't it? But they are saying it's a matter of life and death. So the pain causes the baby to cry, the lungs open, now everybody is rejoicing. Now once the baby starts breathing, 8 years later, it is still? He can't say, but can't I go on holiday? No, you cannot go on holiday and try to spend an hour without breathing. The same way, prayer is what allows you to get the energy from God. To do what I've just been describing, it will need you to have a constant talk with God. Of course, there are all kinds of prayers. There is prayer. You can go for a prayer retreat and spend a week praying. There's praying and fasting. But you must pray all the time. There's what you call ejaculatory prayer. You just shout to God. Sometimes you pray with your eyes closed. Sometimes when you are driving, you are praying. And it's not advisable to close your eyes. You do an accident. Now, praying without ceasing, praying all types of prayers. And when you are in touch with God, whenever you feel like erupting, He reminds you He is still in control. And so you are able. Number one, that's one. The second thing He reminds you is vengeance, its mind says
the Lord.
That even if it is true that Kiberebere lady wanted to hurt you. In other words, you have verified. You have given them benefit of doubt, given them a chance to defend, but you realize they were doing it deliberately to annoy you. Even after that, the Bible says, don't be like them. Do not revenge. Vengeance is mine. In other words, leave that Kiberebere into God's hands. And you atanyaroshwa. Sina wewe na Mungu mwenyewe. So why do you want to get involved? And God has already told you not to get involved. Here is when you have already verified that the person really wanted you to be annoyed. Don't, you know, when somebody wants to annoy you, if you get annoyed, they feel very nice. Remember, that's what they wanted. They wanted to annoy you. Then you get annoyed, they have succeeded. I can tell you, if you want to handle your enemy, don't get annoyed. They will not sleep at night. Because they had done their best to bring you down. You never went
down.
So why do you want to reward your enemy? By doing what they wanted you to do. You need to understand. But I'm back to this. It's prayer that will give you the energy. Seeking God. Being intimate with God. That will give you the energy to be able to say, I can handle this girl. Given my muscles, she may need to sleep at the Nairobi Hospital. But I'm not doing it. I'm leaving her in God's hand. So you continue in the same group. Despite the fact that somebody hurt you. Why? You have forgiven them. Remember, if you don't forgive the other person in the group, somebody has said, when you don't forgive me, it's like taking poison and assuming it will hurt me. You know, you prepare the poison for your enemy, then you say, Ataniona. Then you drink it yourself. And you're hoping I'm going to hurt. No. So when you get annoyed with me, it is you it will work on. Remember, the body chemicals start operating. That's how you end up in stomach ulcers. Your enemy is still rejoicing because he wanted you to be annoyed and you got
annoyed.
You end up in hospital and the guy is still rejoicing. Do yourself a favor. Forgive them and leave them in God's hands. When you do that, you will still be able to smile to them. You will be able, you have forgiven them. It's not bothering you anymore. You left them in God's hands. So you can continue in the group. Running away from the group is a sign you have not forgiven. And you know, one of the things I fear about forgiveness when I discovered it, I found it very difficult. You know, whenever you say the Lord's Prayer, it tells us to say, "Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us." And to somebody say, "Do you know it's a legal term?" Those who are lawyers, it's a legal term. You are praying to God, "Please don't forgive me until and unless I forgive others." The day I learned the meaning, I said, "Will I still be praying the Lord's Prayer?" Because you are pleading with God not forgive you until you also
forgive you.
Listen again. "Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass
against us."
In other words, the reason you will forgive me is because I also
forgive.
So when somebody in the group has annoyed you and you leave the group with a half, it's a sign you have not forgiven them. It's a sign God will also not forgive you. Because that's what he is actually saying. So it's important to ask yourself, in this group, do you have forgiveness? And even in marriage, I don't think there's a marriage that can last without forgiveness. And I think that's an important issue. Let's go now to the book of Ephesians, chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. I've wrapped up the verse. "As a prisoner for the Lord, I urge you." I think it's verse 1. But you can check it once you're in Ephesians chapter 4. I've wrapped up the verse. Verse?
1.
1, yes. I should have left it there. So verse 1. Can somebody read it for us?
"I therefore, a prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you are called, with all lowliness and gentleness and long suffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace."
Up to there. Please note who is writing. Is a guy in prison. He exactly wrote the book from a prison. And he's saying, I'm not a prisoner of the state. I'm a prisoner of the Lord. Why? If the Lord wanted to take me out of prison, he could accomplish it, isn't it? Remember the jailer who at night the doors opened? He was about to kill himself because he wondered what will happen to me. God is capable of opening the jail and releasing. So Paul is saying, I'm a prisoner of the Lord. I'm in difficult circumstances. But I am somebody who is immovable. This prison thing has not. In Philippians chapter 1, he says some people were happy to hear I'm in prison. But you know, since I came to prison, good things are happening. It is affecting people in Caesar's household. Have you read that? That the imprisonment of Paul was finally a way of getting the gospel into the emperor's house. You see, he is tied to one guy here, one guy here, 24 hours. They come every 8 hours. He preaches the first one, round one. The next one comes. Within no time, they started getting saved. Since he could never, Christianity could never have entered the emperor's house. He needed to be jailed for the emperor to hear the word. So he changes the circumstance into something positive. That's Philippians chapter 1. You need to be the kind of a person, if you are going to be somebody and a group that can move through every season, a person who can move with a group through every season, you must start understanding adverse circumstances could work for good. As a prisoner of the Lord. What is it, the challenges this group is going through, which God can use for positive measure to accomplish the goals of the group? He says, I understand when you are going through a difficult time, but I urge you the following: to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. If you want to be the kind of person who can go through every season, number one, you must live a life worthy of the calling you have received. In other words, don't act on the basis of the circumstances. Don't act on the basis of the people who are harassing you. Act on the basis of who you are. Act as a, live a life worthy of your calling. If the people around you will tempt you, the people around you will harass you. But it's important to understand you have a calling. You are not like them. You are a human being like them. But you are not like them. You know, every time most of us who are Christians sin, say, but I'm also human. You are a human, but you must understand you are a Christian. Are we together?
Yes.
That's what it's calling. So do not act on the basis of you can understand. You know, I'm from NASA. You should understand. Whereas I told the other person to understand you, you should also understand the other person. Are we together?
Yes.
So here Paul is saying you must live a life worthy of your calling. Don't act as per the environment. Be a thermostat, not a thermometer. What does a thermometer do? Goes up and down depending on the temperature. What does a thermostat do? It stops the temperature rising or falling at the way you have set it. And some people are thermometers, not thermostats. If this group will go far, we must encourage more and more members to stop being thermometers and become
thermostats.
Where you are regulating the temperature of the group. You don't hear that Sister Keberebere was annoying, did our annoying thing. You say, yes, even me. Let's chase her out. Now, that's a thermometer, not a
thermostat.
You need to be a regulating force. And we are not suggesting you cover up issues. Justice is also important. But there's a way of doing justice that can bring peace, isn't it? And this verse talks about it later. Number two, you must be completely humble. The verse has told us. I don't know why it is using the word completely humble. What did your version say? After leaving wildlife or other calling, the other one is what? Be completely or be what?
Be completely humble
and gentle. Be completely humble. No, okay, so that's the same version with mine. What, you have to say it?
Gentleness, no suffering, bearing.
Before gentleness was what?
Lowliness.
Okay, that's the one our version is calling humble. Yeah. And you need to understand
all lowliness.
Okay. You need to understand that to be that person who can be a friend in time of need, who can be a friend to a hopeless guy who has failed, who can be a friend to somebody who is going bankrupt and is still a member of the group, who can be a friend to Keberebere, you need humility. Humility is thinking of the other person rather than of yourself. Pride is the opposite of humility. Be completely humble means you can be partially humble. For you to be able to cope with the changes of seasons, you must put yourself in them. Number two, be gentle. The other one here is be gentle. The third requirement for you if you are going to be is to be gentle. Humility is not the same as gentleness. Humility is, you know, understanding the other person, not being quarrelsome, not showing pride. Gentleness is handling the other person with care. You are gentle. Oh, so-and-so is a gentleman. I think that's where the British got it. A gentleman handles the other people with gentility. So even ladies can be gentlemen, gentle ladies. Because it means you know how to handle. So if you are really going to get this group through seasons, you must handle other people with gentility. Be gentle in the way you handle others. The next, be patient. Humility is not the same as gentleness, but gentleness is not equal to patience. Who is patient? Patient is the word that is nearer. It is long suffering. What's long suffering? It's suffering long. You know, in other words, you want to give somebody as much rope as possible. They might hang themselves with it, but keep giving them longer rope. So you do not become sensitive so that you react. When I say something, you react immediately. Then you have no patience. Patience means you can give me space to be, you can give me space to go over something. Maybe this is the time I introduce the word suffocating people with love. Suffocating people with love is where you love somebody so seriously he can't breathe. You know, your husband can run away, and it's because you loved him. You know, he can't turn left, can't turn right. He's with you. I mean, everywhere. Now, soon enough, he feels like running away. Good love is a love that allows the other person to be themselves. And allowing them to be themselves means you might allow them to be different. That can only happen because of patience. Are there people who are your friends, but they want to investigate you? By the way, the way your husband was looking today, he looked annoyed. I didn't see it. No, tell the truth, you are lying. What was he, why was he looking up instead of looking down? Now, where is it written, thou shalt never look down? But people can drill you and drill you in the name of love. Next time you see them, would you want to be near them? And they wonder, I love so-and-so so much. How come they're running away from? It's because you don't give them space to be
themselves.
Actually, your intentions are pure. Your intention is for you, and I think that will be important for us to understand, your intention is for you to show them love. But because you are not giving them space, they come themselves. As you remember, emphasizing in a marriage seminar, emphasizing the importance of people having a budget together. And that's a subject for another day. And the benefits of doing it together with a spouse. Having one team, rather than two teams trying to be in the same house. Then a young couple listened and implemented and decided everything will be budgeted. And they agreed the best way of saving, they were a young couple, the best way of saving is no lunch, no buying lunch in town. We will make the lunch and we carry it in the morning. The young man carried it once, then he felt very embarrassed in the office because nobody was carrying lunch. That's more than 20 years ago. Their children are in the university, so it's not recent. One time, I don't know how the young man used money that was not in the budget. And on a Sunday morning, they started quarreling, and they quarreled so hard that by the time they were looking at the watch, it was past Sunday service. And they are serious Christians, but they lost a Sunday service quarreling. And it just started as they are putting on their clothes to go to church. They quarreled over money. So it started ringing me, but I was preaching somewhere out of town. When I arrived, our house telephone rang. Said, you must come. I said, I'm tired. Can I come another day? No, it's urgent. Tell Rebecca, we need you urgently. So despite our being tired, we had to go to the house. And they explained, the reason we are calling you is we have had a very bad day. We never went to church. And so they explained the story. I said, you mean for your husband to buy a soda which is not in the budget, they must clear with you? That's what we agreed. I said, my friend, I know you are doing it the way we talked it, but I'm the one to blame. I should have told you, even in budgeting, there's something called contingency. Every budget allows contingency. Yes. Normally, if I was working, it would never be more than 5%. If you use your budget beyond just 5% above, it can be understood. Beyond 5%, you may be fired. It means you allow room for decisions without consultation. Am I right? So any team that does not allow that contingency will die. People feel suffocated because they can't. Like some of I see teams where if you fail to come to a meeting, they tell you not to show up again. Now, what about if I'm not feeling like coming today? Okay, if I don't come many meetings, then throw me out. But you must give me room to feel to come once or twice. Am I communicating? You are allowing room for somebody to be themselves without explaining. That means if you go beyond that, you must explain why you never came. But one meeting is enough to say, sorry, today I'm not coming. Why? It's personal. And they are given that freedom. When you give people that freedom, they feel loved. They feel they are a part of the group. They feel you are understanding what they are going through. And you don't have to put in public. For example, they're having a quarrel with the husband. Do you want them to come and tell the whole group, My husband called me, I couldn't have come for the meeting. Now, allow them not to say exactly why. That's what you mean by being patient with them so that you give them room to be themselves. Any friendship that forces everybody to be uniform is not Christian. You must allow people. That's why you cannot require that everybody who comes must wear a hat. You know, because our sister enjoys wearing hats. Now, there are people who don't like hats, isn't it? That's why a good group has principles but does not go to dictates of details. As long as people are keeping the principles, the details, you allow to be yourself. Am I communicating?
Yeah.
The moment you want to control people to the details, you just people start voting with their... What did I say? Adults vote with their...
Yes.
They just disappear. And you wonder why we never did anything. There's nothing wrong you have done, but they are feeling those rules are too strict. Obviously, every group must have rules. On major issues, there must be agreement. On minor issues, freedom to differ. That means somebody can be wearing a color you don't like every day. You don't like color red. Every time they come, you feel like dying. Please don't die. Let them keep coming, because the color of the dress is not one of the major issues of the group. Am I communicating?
Yes.
So you need to understand that. What does it mean? It means I can be in NASA, and I'm proud of being in NASA, and I won't support things. That's a political view. Do not force me to have your political view, because it is not a political group. Among the objectives of this group, does it include converting others to your party? So it means we continue the same group, even if we are diametrically opposed on a minor issue. And we call politics a minor issue, because even the voting by our constitution is secret, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
That means a husband can vote one way and the wife another way, and they go to the same bedroom. And there will be no quarrel, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So if husbands can differ and remain married, why would a group like this be separating because of political differences? You are going beyond the necessary controls. You need to be clear that politics is free. You can support your candidate, but don't use this group, at least not in the meetings, to win a candidate on your side. And that means we understand you when you start rejoicing because the Supreme Court has annulled Jubilee's results. But if you keep going, you're not becoming political, isn't it? So it's important to understand. I will understand you when you start refusing to take milk, in case it's Brookside, you know. But if you start talking about it like, what? You are taking milk? How do you know it's not Brookside? Now you are bringing politics into this group. After all, there are people who are not rioting and they don't take milk. The doctor told them not to take. So why do you have to explain to us why you're not taking milk? Simply stop taking milk. Don't involve the group in those kind of details, because they are not part of the principles, I'm assuming, Colette. They are not part of the principles that control the group.
No.
So to bring them is a sign of misunderstanding and not very mature to be trying to control people on the level of details. And remember the word I'm using is, the Bible is calling it patience. That means you don't agree with me, but you are patient with me. I'm not asking you to join me, but on those issues, don't. Of course, there are issues that are cardinal. For example, you may have principles of immorality that you do not want to have a group of members who are immoral. So once one of you becomes a prostitute, they can't see it, but they cannot say it's personal. You decide that one is in the principles, that this group is made up of moral people. So once you become a prostitute, it's a way of resigning from the group. But it's personal. What I do at the blanket and with who, and I'm an adult, why are you entering into it? No, the group said we all must be people who are immoral. Why? Because if my husband knows I go to the house of so-and-so who is immoral, she thinks I'm also trying to become
immoral.
And my marriage will be in trouble. And instead of my marriage breaking, I would rather leave the group. I'm getting the point. And I haven't talked to collectors who ask what are your principles. I haven't asked and I haven't read your document. But I'm just trying to show you the difference between cardinal issues that must be agreed and minor issues that don't have to be agreed. That is Romans chapter 14. And it's also repeated in chapter 15. Paul is saying we must accept each other on major issues, agreement. On minor, allow the weak not to eat meat. If they don't want to eat meat. So it's important to understand what are the critical. Be patient with the people who are different. But when it comes to cardinal issues, you cannot claim you are being accommodative by accommodating people who are breaking their principles. For example, maybe you give money and you can see somebody is swimming in money and they refuse to give any money for a long period of time. Is that a major principle or a minor one?
Major.
So it's important to understand what are those. And you need to go through your principles and find what are the principles that are more details than principles and start releasing them out of the group. That's what will hold a group longer. When people feel they are free to be different on most issues and they only have to be together on these particular issues. And they need to be clearly known, debated, and agreed. I think it will be important that that is done. So the word of God is saying, is calling it patience. You must have patience. And you need to ask yourself whether that's what you are doing or not. And the other word is used is bearing with one another. In love, bearing with one another. Patience and bearing are related. But bearing with one another means carrying someone. That means he may not have given money for one week. But you are willing, 1 month, but you are willing to give them time. You are bearing with them. They are doing something wrong, but you are also bearing with them, giving them time, counseling them, talking to them. You don't remove somebody and you have not even understood what he is going through. That's bearing with one another. The next one is make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit. In other words, it's not easy to be in unity. You have to make effort. It's a hard work. If you just allow the group to run well on its own, from this verse, it will not work. Effort is required. So you cannot assume the group will have unity if there is no process and effort. It will cost you something. For example, to be here, you canceled an appointment, isn't it? You know, whenever you hear somebody, sorry, I'm not able to come, it's only they are being courteous. So they are telling you, what I'm doing is more important than coming for the meeting. Because nobody is here who never canceled something. Am I right?
Yes.
Everybody had to cancel something. They counted this thing as more important than others. It means effort. If you want the group to run, you must sacrifice something else. You must talk to your spouse about why you need to be in this group. You don't say, but my husband suggested we go to the village. Why didn't you tell your husband 1 month ago that the day you meet is normally this one? Well, you are not making effort. That's what you mean by making effort. And then finally, you must have the bond of peace. Bond of peace. And the word of God is clear. It says, be at peace with everyone in as far as it depends on you. That means there are people who may not be peaceful with you, but in your sight, you are not the one causing lack of peace. A group will run well when that has happened. Let me finish by looking at Ecclesiastes chapter 4. Verse 9 to 10. Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 9 to 10. Two are better than one, because they have a good return for their labor. If either of them falls down, one can help the other up. But pity anyone who falls and has no one to help them up. I've changed subject. I've been talking about how you can run the group together and continue through every season. This one now is giving you a reason as to why you should make the effort. Why should you make the effort? Because two are better than
one.
That in this group, there are certain benefits, there are certain challenges also, there are certain benefits you have missed if you never join this group. And there are certain benefits you will lose if you leave this group. Two are better than one because they have a good return. The ROI, the return on investment, gets higher when you work together with others. And even in your entrepreneurship, when you have only depending on your capital, you are going to make your business this big. When you put two people's capital, the business becomes
bigger.
That's what the word of God is saying. And we answering the question, why should people work together? Because they have higher return. Number two, because when somebody makes a mistake, the other one can correct them. In fact, here it is saying, either of them falls down, the other one can help them up. And next, he says, if you don't have anybody to help you up, then you need pity. Because then there's nobody who will lift you up. I finish with this statement which you have heard before. If you want to go fast, go alone. There's a way of admitting that work in a group will slow you down. In my vernacular, they say, Kamwingi koyaga adere, nogatiaga shira, in English. When you work together with the people, you are able to lift. Dere is the pesto where you used to make the you know, you put maize, then two women have pestles and they work on it until they have crushed it, until it becomes, that's the way you produce porridge from maize. And normally what they used to do is to get a part of a tree, big tree, then remove a bit of it in the inside, and that's where they will put the maize. You put a little water and the maize, and you scratch it. Unfortunately, that thing is normally put in a place by a group of people. After that, you can never remove it alone. So you have to be going there every time you want to do your maize. Have you ever seen a dairy?
Yes.
So you know what I'm talking about. Yeah. So they say, when you have a group, it's useful. Why? They can move the
dairy.
The dairy. They can move that wood thing for making the porridge. You can't do it alone. You can't even do it with your husband. So a group is good. It helps to lift. So you need to understand the reason you are together is because together you can achieve more. However, if you want to go fast, please understand the group will not work. If you need three people to leave that thing, you'll be able to get your husband. The other guy will keep saying, can I come tomorrow? To 1 week, you still have not moved the dairy. And that's something you need to understand as you come to the group. If you want to go fast, resign from the group. The group helps you to do more. In fact, I should finish the other sentence. But if you want to go far, go as a team. Let me now read the whole thing. If you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go as a team. In other words, if you want to make big, long-term transformation, if you want to get big impact, then don't go alone, go in a team. But of course, the statement already owns up that it slows you down. There'll be things that will be done by this group that you don't want. For example, they should be rejoicing when Uhuru has won. I don't know. I don't enjoy the group. Why can't they rejoice and my candidate has won? Now, if you join the group, it will slow you down. You need to accept that. That if you really want to go fast, go alone. So you must allow that slowness of the group. Why? Because that slowness gives you impact. You are likely to get a higher return, like the Bible told us. You are likely to become bigger impact. You are likely to apply more wisdom. And maybe at another time, we need to discuss group dynamics and as a term. Because you are a group. And there is a whole science of group dynamism. And it's important to understand at what stage your group is and what the challenge it is going through. So you should ask a speaker to come and talk to you about group dynamics. But it's important to understand that.